Why don't we make a project to analyze how people are watching it?
Grace Hopper's Celebration of Women in Computing coverage continues in a moment.
Live from Houston, Texas, it's theCUBE. Covering Grace Hopper's Celebration of Women in Computing.
Welcome back to theCUBE's coverage of the Grace Hopper Conference. We are live in Houston, Texas. I'm Rebecca Knight, your host. Today our guest is Amanda Gisharu. She is the co-founder of Tech Republic Africa, also an ABI winner. This is the Anita Borg Institute winner for Change Agent. Mm-hmm. This is for your work in giving girls and women in Kenya opportunities in the tech industry.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so happy to be here.
So talk to me about your career. You actually started your career at the UN, and you started in development and then moved on to Google.
Yeah, so I did start my career in development, and that was because I always knew since I was a child that I wanted to do something to make the world a better place and just bring positive impact and change. So I started off in Italy working for the World Food Program around food security, specifically in communications and fundraising, just to make sure that, you know, programs are sustainable and we're able to scale. And then from there, I actually moved on to do my master's in communications to learn more about how I could effectively raise funds for nonprofits and social enterprise. And then from there, I returned home to Kenya and worked with the United Nations Development Program around several aspects of development, from governance to energy, food security, conflict. So I got a more high level look at, you know, the entire, I guess, landscape of development issues that we do have within the region. And then at that point, I felt that, you know, international civil service was a bit slow and a bureaucratic. So I thought, you know, I want to go to a company that'll bring positive change, but is a bit more fast moving. And that's how I ended up at Google, actually.
Yeah. And so you're at Google, but you also have this real part of you that, as you said, wants to make the world a better place.
Yeah.
So what did you see at Google that made you?
Yeah. So at Google, it's very much, I guess, a startup type of environment. They're always looking to innovate, and with their innovations, they're trying to make a positive impact for the world. And specifically at the time when they had opened up the offices in Africa, they were trying to demonstrate to the local population how the internet could make an impact in their everyday life in a more positive way. So that really was attractive to me, because we do have challenges within the country where we have a high mobile phone penetration. It's at 88%, but there's a lot of ignorance around what you can do with that phone beyond like messaging and calls. So for me, I wanted to be part of that narrative and help people understand you could use the internet to access information, and knowledge is power. So I was working in product marketing, consumer awareness. It was less around, you know, corporate, let's make money kind of consumer marketing, and more around positive social impact. How can we show the local people how they can use the internet to make their lives better?
And so, as you said, 88% penetration in Kenya, and yet so few people really understood the power of this little device they were carrying around in their pocket. And in particular, women.
Yes.
So the problem you were trying to solve in founding Tech Republic Africa.
Yeah. So what we looked at, like I said, while I was at Google, is digital literacy, right? How do people understand how to use the device and the internet? And while we're going around the country trying to, you know, help people have this understanding, I realized it's really deeply rooted in our education system, where people are learning, I'd say, industrial age type skills, whereas right now we're in the artificial intelligence age. And if you actually graduate from our Kenyan education system, you're not able to compete globally, and the world is now global. We have to look at ourselves from that perspective. And women and girls are particularly at a disadvantage, because they do have challenges accessing even basic education. So accessing STEM education is completely out of the question. So I left Google to start Tech Republic Africa with their support as well. And we're looking at how we can reach kids in, you know, rural areas as well as, I'd say, disadvantaged urban areas, and educate them on STEM with a skew towards CS and tech. Because what's happening is when they do graduate from our local schools, their skills are equipping them to be more employees and less entrepreneurs and innovators. And that's led to a very high level of unemployment because people come out and are looking for jobs as opposed to starting their own initiatives. So with our program, we don't only teach them STEM skills, we also teach them soft skills and business skills so that once they complete the program, they're in a position to start their own initiatives and create jobs and grow the economy.
I want to talk about the results that you're seeing, but I also want to ask about the parents, because so much of this too is parents either seeing opportunity for their young daughters or not seeing opportunity and really needing to be persuaded that this is a viable path for their daughters. Mm-hmm. How much outreach do you have to do to parents too?
Yeah, that's actually the first point of contact because they are, like you said, they're decision makers. So we actually do run workshops and awareness at schools and within the universities that we partner with to educate parents. They are also, you know, part of the system in the sense that they went through the same education system. So they also have that same level of, you know, lack of information on STEM and the opportunities that exist currently. So we do have workshops, two-day workshops, where we literally take the parents through the, like, a taste of the program, help them understand the opportunities, expose them a bit more. And we also use a lot of peer-to-peer marketing. In Kenya, that seems to be, like, much more effective and credible. When I hear from another parent, like, hey, you know, my students went through this particular, you know, program and this is how they benefited. So that's worked for us as well.
So what are some of the challenges that you see for women getting this education? Mm-hmm. What are some of the biggest hurdles?
Yes, I'd say that Kenya and maybe the wider part of wider Africa is still very patriarchal. So what you find is women entering the workforce have to work twice as hard because they have to be taken seriously, they have to gain credibility, and also they have to face the brunt of, I guess, this social conditioning that, you know, a woman's place is in the home and having children and taking care of the home and less in, you know, the corporate world or even, you know, as an entrepreneur building her own business and, you know, creating her own path. So that's really been a challenge for these girls to get them to understand that, you know, as much as women are perceived as that, we are the backbone of our society. If you actually look at a typical Kenyan household, you'll find that a mother could be at home, yes, looking after the children, but at the same time, maybe she has a small side business where she's selling vegetables, or she's making clothes, or she's baking cakes and selling them. So they actually are entrepreneurs. They just don't label themselves as that. And you need to tap into that particular, what should I say, will to do whatever it takes to survive and take care of their families and innovate, because they are innovating in their own way.
And so and so you have these women who, as you said, are small business owners because they are making things and then selling them, also running their households, making decisions probably that affect their children, their husband.
Yeah.
Is there a sense that things are changing in the sense of becoming a less patriarchal society? Do you sense an underlying change?
Yes. So from a policy perspective at the government level, there has been a big push towards empowering women more. So there are policies that were recently established that allow women, or rather enable women, to hold more positions in government. And of course that's, you know, very impactful generally for women across the board because they are in a position to make decisions that will make things easier for women to get into business, into, you know, positions of power, influence within the government or the corporate world. So there is that change. And then you'll find because of programs like ours as well as other institutions who are working towards educating women, girls are feeling a bit more empowered and starting to realize, hey, like, actually, I have a position of influence, like you said, within the household, and I can be able to take this further and have positions of influence within the corporate world or within governance as well.
And you are a nonprofit right now, but you said that you may be moving a little bit toward the social enterprise model.
Yes.
Can you talk about that?
So generally, if you look at the world right now and, you know, the recent economic recessions that have taken place, it's become a bit more challenging for nonprofits, especially small nonprofits, to access sustainable and consistent grant funding. So as a result, a lot of nonprofits are shifting towards the social enterprise model that allows them to carry out some commercial operations to allow them to, you know, be more sustainable as opposed to being dependent exclusively on grants. Yes, so that's what we're looking at right now. now, just reconfiguring and restructuring our business so that we are sustainable. And if grant funds do come in, yes, it'll be supplementary, but not the main source of funding for us to run our programs.
So let's talk a little bit about Grace Hopper. We are here in Houston, Texas, the biggest tech conference, biggest technical tech conference for women. What are your impressions? What are your thoughts?
First, it's amazing, like the energy in here. 15,000 plus delegates coming together just to understand more about the tech world, opportunities for growth in their careers, understanding like cutting edge, you know, innovations taking place. It's amazing. I'm learning so much. This is actually my first time here, so I'm so grateful for the opportunity. And it's been an amazing first day. This is the second day. I'm learning a lot. I wish I could actually be in all these different workshops, like in multiple places at once.
Yes, you wish you could divide yourself and go to multiple.
Exactly, because there's so much to do. It's a great experience. I hope to be back here next year as well, just to keep learning and growing. And I've met so many interesting people, not only just from a career perspective and challenging myself as a woman and what I can do, but also from, you know, a perspective of understanding where my country could go and could be within the global tech sphere. Yeah.
I'd love to talk a little bit about the election right now, too, and just in sort of the backdrop that this conference is taking place against.
Yeah.
I mean, particularly you live in Nairobi, so you live many, many miles away from what's taking place here in the U.S.
Yes.
But does it seem, I mean, you're talking about this patriarchal society in Kenya, and we like to think that we've moved on, that we are a more progressive, socially aware culture, but what... How do you see this election, and what do you what are the impressions that you have being in Kenya, watching Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton?
So in Kenya, we're watching very closely. So in my country, our celebrities are politicians, so we're very much into the political sphere, the arena, and what goes on there. So we're watching very closely, and for me, it's interesting to observe that at this juncture, it's very like there's a political revolution, I guess you could call it, because it's unexpected that the candidates that actually have made it to this point in the race are here. Hillary has all this experience, and then Trump comes from, you know, the corporate sector. And it's a very, I'll just call him an interesting character.
Do you have an apprentice in Kenya?
We actually had an apprentice of Kenyan origin here in the U.S. who made it into so Trump is not like, and he's very familiar to us, I'd say. It's just unexpected that he chose to go this direction and that he's made it this far. That was very unexpected. For Hillary, it isn't as unexpected, obviously, because she has this long-running career. But for us, it's, I don't know, it's, the only word I can use is unusual. And we're watching very closely.
That's a mild word to describe this.
Yes, I'm trying to be diplomatic. I'll just say unusual. Some would say entertaining, but I wouldn't call it entertaining. I'd say it's very concerning because I've been following the debates and I've been looking at how it's less about policy and development and moving the country forward and more about individuals and personality and mudslinging in some sense.
Well, particularly for Kenya. So we have President Obama, who is on his way out, who has a Kenyan father, really a son of Kenya.
Yes.
So, I mean, how do you feel to watch the first African-American president exit office?
Wow, I mean, it's sad for us because we're always saying that's our son, that's our own, that Kenya helped actually like raise him in a sense. He's leaving an amazing legacy. So he's done a lot of work, especially in international relations and the work that he's done in Africa. I recently actually just completed a state-sponsored program called Tech Women. And it selects women from Africa, Asia, and the Middle East and brings them to Silicon Valley and places at different companies for a month-long mentorship where we'd learn more about what local companies are doing here within the tech world. And that's something that he started. So it's been amazing what he's done. I just hope that whoever does make it into office is able to continue and build on the work that he's done.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Amanda Gisharu. Thank you so much for joining us here at theCUBE's coverage of the Grace Hopper Conference in Houston, Texas. We will be back after this short break.
Hi, I'm John Furrier.